Welcome back to our intermediate financial accounting class. In our last few segments, we've been wrapping up our discussion of pensions. Now we get to move on to the last of our topics in this module, and that is leases. And we're going to break our discussion of leases down into two different parts. Now, as we jump into this conversation, you need to know that leases is probably the most controversial or hot topic in accounting today. You see, for a long time, FASB had a really complex set of rules for leases. It broke it down into two different types, operating and capital leases. Now, most companies preferred to use the operating style because the journal entries were really simple. You would debit rent expense, credit cash, or if you were the lessor, you'd debit cash and credit rent, and that was about it. Under the capital lease structure, we treated it like a sale. So the lessor would actually transfer the asset off of their books, and the lessee would put the asset, and more importantly, the lease liability onto their books. And in order to decide where this threshold was, where you would change from one type to the other, from operating to capital, FASB had four specific rules. And companies really took advantage of these four rules. They would get right up to the border so they didn't have to switch to a capital lease. Most companies preferred that operating lease style because not only was it simple, but it also kept the liability off of their books and they didn't have to depreciate the asset either. So there were a couple of reasons why lessees just wanted to keep this off of their books. So one of the rules, for example, was if you pay 90% of the market value of this asset over the life of the lease, then you have to capitalize it, because you've essentially bought it. At least that was FASB's logic. So what companies would do is they would work with the lessor and get up to like 89.9% of the market value. And then they hadn't quite crossed the threshold and they could still call it an operating lease. So they would get as close to the border as they could and then they'd stop and they would keep it as an operating lease. Well, not only was FASB upset with this, technically breaking the law, but it is kind of unethical to structure it specifically so that you avoid what FASB's intention was, where if you get up to that 90% or thereabouts threshold, you would start to say, you know, essentially I'm buying this, I'm paying most of the value. So because of this, FASB was upset, the SEC was upset, a lot of other regulators and analysts were upset, and investors were upset. For example, looking at FedEx's financial statements, you don't see any of those trucks or those planes that we see everywhere because they were leased and they'd structured the leases as operating leases. So they didn't show up on their financial statements at all except as a very large rent expense and cash outflow. So because of this pushback and because of the manipulations by Enron and WorldCom and some of those other big frauds, FASB decided it was time to close this gap or this hole. Sorry, I shouldn't have said gap. No pun intended there. But that's what they've been doing for about 3 years. It was such a controversial topic with auditors and regulators pushing one way, let's capitalize everything, and firms pushing back saying, no, you'll kill our balance sheets. You can't do that to us. It's taken a long time to get here. And finally, after about 3 years of deliberations, FASB has passed the rule that now gives us the new accounting for leases. And the rules are still complex. That didn't change. But what they've done is they've gotten rid of these loopholes. So essentially for the lessee, everything is going to be a capitalized lease. And as for the lessor, well, we weren't as worried about them in the past. So we've still left them with some more flexibility. Sometimes they can show it as a sale and get it off their books. Sometimes they can just still show that rent revenue coming in. Still a lot more details to it, but a very different process than what we used to see. So whether you agree with FASB's decision or not, everyone is now scrambling to figure out how to do leases and get their books accurate under the new rules. This is going to hit a lot of companies very hard. A friend of mine actually has been a business consultant, tax guru for a number of years. And we were talking about this issue at a conference a little while ago. And he made the point that he's been telling his clients now for a couple of years, this is coming. Some version of it is going to happen. You have to be ready. And companies kept pushing back, oh, there's no need. It's not going to be that big of a deal. We don't have to. And he finally stopped him and said, no, you don't understand. If you have to capitalize these leases, your assets are going to look better, but think about your debts. Your long-term debt is going to go way up. And you have debt covenants that you've made with the bank that if you get too much of a percentage of your financing from debt, they can call in all of your bonds or your notes or your mortgages or loans, whatever. You could be in a lot of trouble because you violated debt covenants, not because you've changed your business, but because of what FASB's told you you have to put on your balance sheet. You have to start right now to figure out what these rules are going to do and start renegotiating your debt covenants, or you're going to be in trouble. So this has been a really big issue for a lot of companies, and that's really why this is such an important topic now. But let's add just another couple of things to this discussion. So in addition to it being a hot topic right now in accounting, you also need to know that financing is just a huge part of the economy. I mean, a lot of companies enter into leases because they can't get other types of financing or because the interest rates would be too high. So we need to make sure we're comfortable with it just because it is such a big part of the financing process. Also, lease classification is a big issue. It's been an issue in the past. It's still going to be an issue with the new rules. The new styles aren't quite as different as the old styles were, but they still are different. So we still do have to be comfortable with both of the styles and how you decide between them and comfortable with the methods that are there. And then this other note, of course, is about how important this topic is because it has changed so drastically in the last little while. The next thing we need to talk about are just a couple of basic definitions. And most of these you probably already know from finance classes or your own contracts that you've entered into or that your family has dealt with or just because of other business classes. But just to review them, let's make sure everybody's comfortable. A lease is a contract that does not sell an asset. Instead, I give you the right to use an asset and I retain ownership. So that's what a lease is. The lessee, the person who wants to use the asset, gets the right of use. The lessor, who owns the asset, keeps the asset, but in return for some kind of payment, gives the lessee the right to use the asset. These lease contracts can be very complex. You probably remember signing a lease for an apartment. Maybe it's an apartment while you're going to school for college or perhaps doing an internship, etc. But they're long documents with lots of different factors in them. What kind of payments have to be made, how much the payments are, what kind of a deposit has to be made up front, how long you get to use the asset, how you get to return the asset, etc. So there's a lot of different things that are part of these contracts. They're very detailed. They keep lawyers busy and accounting firms busy and tax professionals busy trying to figure out all the ins and outs of the accounting. Now, they become really popular because they give both lessees and lessors some very distinct advantages. Under the old rules, there were some additional benefits for taxes and appearance, etc. Those are going away under the new rules, but there's still some significant business benefits to a lease, which will probably keep this industry going strong, although there has been some pushback with FASB's changes that this might kill or cripple the lease industry. But because of the size of the industry already, because of some of these benefits that aren't contingent upon the accounting, then there's probably a good chance that we'll keep seeing leases for a long time. For the lessee, there are two really important benefits. First is they can get 100% financing. You don't have to generate a down payment or 50% payment, and you typically get a lower interest rate because the other individual still owns the asset, which means it's very easy for the lessor to show up and say, you've stopped making payments. I'm taking my machine or the building back. And it's much easier to do that than it is to try to foreclose, say, a mortgage or to call in a bond, etc. So there's a real benefit there for the lessee that they get the lower interest rate and don't have to have a down payment. Also benefit for the lessor. Also, the lessee is protected against obsolescence. So if I start using a machine and a year later I find out that there's a better machine that fits into my production model better, I can go back to my lessor and say, you know what, swap me from this machine to that machine. And because of the relationship we've got and because I can just give them back their asset, I can do that. I'm not locked into a mortgage. I haven't purchased the asset outright. I can swap it relatively easily as long as I'm willing to make the higher payments. From the lessor's perspective, hey, I've got a steady source of income. We've mentioned that already. I've got a high residual value because most lessees are going to want to change things out before they go obsolete, which means that I may rent a car to an office company for 2 years, and then they're going to swap it out. Well, I've still got a car that's only 2 years old. I can resell that as opposed to getting something that's been beat up. I can also put in the contract that they have to restore it to a certain level of quality. in order to get a deposit back, etc. So I've got some flexibility there. Also, I've got a much higher likelihood of making a sale, either because I can get most of the value from the lessee, sell it at a discount, and still make my money on the market after the lease, or because we get to the end of the lease and the lessee says, you know, I'd kind of like to keep that. Well, sure, you paid for most of it anyway. Let's make a deal. And so there's some real benefits to the lessor. They become so popular that now we even see rental centers that sell to end consumers, where the end consumer, we don't care what the accounting is, but the rental company will structure the lease so that at the end, the individual or family can keep the asset and they get their money from the lease payments and a nice rate of interest, and they can repossess it if you stop, etc. But it's become beneficial not only between businesses, but also to individual customers as well. Now, that wraps up our conceptual discussion of leases and why they're so important. When we come back, we'll start talking about the new regulations, the new rules, and how we put that all together to actually make some journal entries and account for leases. Fun stuff coming up. We'll see you then.